many you've made mistakes before, but by the grace of God, you can continue to walk in the victory that Jesus paid for. Let's just do this. Everyone reach up to heaven. Just reach up to God as an act of surrender. God, we recognize that we're nothing without you. So, Lord, take the sinner right now. We thank you, Lord God, for everything that you've done for us. God, that you paid the price so that we can walk in total freedom, that we can walk in complete victory every single day. We look to you in this moment right now, and we give you all the glory, Lord. We worship you. We worship you, Lord Jesus.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say.
just want to encourage you here today that God has mercy and grace for you, that He has prepared a place for you. He made a home for you, and that His heart's desire is to have a family, and you're it. You're the family that He wants. So if there's anyone in this room where you feel ashamed, you feel like you're not worthy of His love right now, just let His love just wash it away. For there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. No one in here is better than the other. The ground is level at the foot of the cross. We've all need Jesus. We've all come here because of Jesus, because of Him. So right now, set your eyes on Jesus. Your hope, your salvation, your deliverer. The one who washes you clean. The one who makes a way for you. Right now it's Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Just take another moment. Just tell Jesus, thank you. Jesus, thank you for making a way for me. Lord, when I was undeserving, you made me worthy of your love because of your blood. And Lord, we all walk in that. Together as one family of believers, we have one Heavenly Father, and we thank you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit that dwells on every single one of us. We worship you, Lord. Come.
Who the sun sets free, oh, is free.
Invite the deacons forward at this time. If you're here in this place and you need someone to pray with you, you're welcome to come out of your seats. Let's continue to set our eyes on Jesus. Continue to worship Him and thank Him.
Jesus, you're wonderful. You are so good. We worship you,
your name. In your heart, just be poured out to him right now. From the day you were born again until this very moment, he has watched over you and took care of you and your needs, and he will never stop. He will never stop. As he has met your needs in the past, he will meet your needs in the future. You will never lack. He is your shepherd. The Lord is your shepherd, and you shall not want for a thing. As we look to him, As we look to him this morning, he pours out his mercy upon you and his grace.
Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills his place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills his place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names.
So just look up to him right now. You know, you can look up with your eyes wide open. Just as you see him seated on the throne today, Lord, we look up to you. Our eyes are upon you. Lord, there are times when we don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you. We look up to you, Jesus, the source of all grace, the source of all blessing. And we just thank you for it today, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And everybody said amen. Aren't you glad you know him this morning? I'm glad I know him. Amen. Well, I'm also glad to know the family of God and the brothers and sisters in here today. If you would, before you're seated, just turn and recognize one another, welcome each other into the house of God, then you can be seated. This morning, just want to welcome everyone, and we welcome those that are watching on the webcast and on Facebook Live. We're glad you've joined us wherever you are this week. I know it's a big vacation week, and some of our people are out vacationing right now. We're happy for you, but we're also happy for ourselves in the house of God today. Amen. And if you're visiting with us for the first time today, we'd love to know about it. At the bottom of your bulletin, there is a Connect card. You would just maybe take a few seconds, fill out your information on that, and you would tear it off. Just put it in the offering bucket when it goes by in a few moments. That way we'll know you were with us here today. We can send you some information about the church. But we would love to meet you. If you're a guest with us today, please stop by the guest center right after service, just to the left of the sanctuary, and let us shake your hand and give you a gift bag that we have prepared for you. So welcome. We're glad to have you here. Well, it's always good stuff happening in the house. Be sure to look at your bulletin for the events and classes that are coming up. I just want to highlight two things. The Men's Speaking the Truth Conference, which is the first weekend of August. It's August the 2nd and the 3rd at Cohutta Springs Lodge. It's a great place to go. It's only $150 for the Friday and Saturday. They are registering people right back here. You can see the banner, the Speaking the Truth banner. And then next two Sundays, we'll have a tent out there. We want all the men. How many men are in the house? Woo, we got some good men in the house. Get together with your brothers in Christ. It's going to be an awesome time. And then next Sunday, we're starting a marriage class. It's called The Story of Marriage. It's the John and Lisa Bevere curriculum. We have Fred and Renee Blackwell will be teaching that over at the Legacy Center. You can go to the website, click on the button, sign up for that, or you can register for it on the chair off in the bottom. Just let us know that you're coming. And you know what? A lot of times people don't come to a marriage class because you think, well, my marriage isn't in trouble. But whether you, there's always some trouble there, isn't there? So, yeah, a little bit. No, just I didn't say that. Strike that from the record. But it's a marriage enhancement class where you'll receive what you need to help your marriage be the best it could possibly be. Amen? And so with no further ado, I'm going to ask Pastor Mirek to come on up. Let's give him a hand. Hallelujah.
All right. Thank you. Love you too. Praise the Lord. We've got some great news to tell you. Last Sunday, we had July 4th weekend as we celebrated. We had Honor Our Heroes right here. We had the mayor, of Roswell here, the chief of police here, the fire chief was here, different policemen of the year, all kind of good things happened here. It went well. And then in the evening, we did Celebrate America, which was held at the Vickery Mills School. And it was a great success. I want to show you some of the thick pictures. We had, we estimate over 1,000 quite easily people that showed up, which is a great, wonderful thing to have happen. And then we had a great altar call. I mean, they say upwards of 100 people came forward. And we had great singers. Our own band sang. They did a great job. And we had food trucks, games, and it was just a great atmosphere. People just hung out the whole time. Had a huge stage. Oh, that's Grace rocking out. Amen. And that's yours truly giving the altar call right there. But it was a powerful, powerful time. And how many of you know that takes money? Am I the only one? But that takes money. See, that lady won that special bike. And we just are so appreciative of this church because we believe in going out of our way to make it possible that people connect with God. And I like to take it higher. It's just a money issue. To get people out of their suburban homes, I feel like giving away like a Corvette or something. They'll just pop it to another level. The suburbanites would come for that. And I can get one very relatively inexpensive. I have a friend. He said, what does that mean? Well, I have connections. But we want to keep upping it. And I just thank God for this house. Amen? We're a house that goes and goes and goes. Actually, this next Saturday, we're joining the Assemblies of Truth downtown, 3 blocks from the stadium, helping Bishop Michael Kenyon with his outreach. And they've got a unique thing, which I kind of like. You know, the Catholics can't have the corner on fried fish. You know, fried fish Fridays, they don't eat meat, so they eat fish. And they give fish, so what they do is they get little cards that say, free fried fish. And they pass them out that very day off. Then they cook none of this frozen stuff, breaded. Fresh fish they cut right there. They got their own bread sauce and they deep fry right there. And yours truly is going to be there to help them out, make this happen. But then they share Christ when they have the crowds come. They have crowds come for free fish. Amen. So we believe in God that we're going to learn from them and also be a blessing to them. And we want to continue to have outreaches and bring about this great saying. We're going to make it hard to go to hell in Roswell. Amen. Say with me, we're going to make it hard to go to hell in Roswell. Amen. I believe it. So I also want to give a shout out to Jeff and Mary Sue all the way from Indiana. She used to be at our church, but go ahead, stand up. Let's give them a hand. All the way from Indianapolis area. God bless you. God bless you. But she's here kind of temporary. Really? Wow. Talk about that. Jenny, come up here. Run, Jenny. Give a hand to Jenny. And get the mic. I'm going to pray for her. Jenny, I have glad news and sad news. The glad news is, where's your home country?
Puerto Rico.
Do you have a heart for Puerto Rico?
Yes.
Have you led mission trips to Puerto Rico?
Yes, I have.
And you really see yourself as a missionary to Puerto Rico?
Yes.
So, I understand you are moving permanently to Puerto Rico.
Yes.
That makes me sad, but also makes me glad, because I believe you're going to set up many missions to Puerto Rico.
Yes, I'm going to make it hard to
go to hell.
Go to hell in Puerto Rico.
Yeah, you can say. She wants to say a few words before. We're going to pray a blessing, but go ahead.
Okay.
No, I do hang on the mic. No.
I'm not going to say a lot.
No, yeah.
All right.
I know you're from Puerto Rico, and my Spanish brethren, they have mucho, mucho fuego, con mucho palabras.
I talk a lot out there, but here I don't talk a lot. Anyway, I just want to thank you and World Harvest Church, Pastor Linda, and the staff here. I want to thank everybody for the opportunities that you've given me to serve in this church. And I don't think if I had been in a different church, I don't think I would have been as prepared to go back home this way.
That's wonderful.
In this church, because I've worked all the ministries that I felt that God had led me to do in order to complete me. And I'm not finished and I'm not perfected, but I know that God will be with me along the way.
Yes.
And I just want to thank everybody, those who supported me and those who don't know me that well, but thank you.
We love you, Jenny. We love her heart for God. Let's pray. Lord, I pray a blessing on Jenny as she goes to be a missionary in her own homeland. Lord, give her right connections with the right church. And Lord, let her establish a beachhead that we can go to Puerto Rico many, many times and hold crusades and bring about that very saying, making it hard to go to hell in Puerto Rico. Lord, anoint her now as she goes. And we speak a blessing over her life in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. And I feel the Lord says, as you're going to follow what God gives you to do, doors will open up for you. And even your healing will manifest to you as you go. And it's going to get better and better and better. Amen?
Amen.
We love you, Jenny. Give her a hand. Praise the Lord. Help her. So it takes money to make things happen. And so what your pastor has to do has to believe God for it. Amen. But we're careful about what we spend around here. But just so you know, we have another major venture at this church in the next 2 weeks. I think it starts next weekend, if I'm correct. This place will be tore up from the floor up. It'll take them 2 weeks, but they're going to install a brand new sound system across this entire auditorium. Come on. What now? We're still having church here. It's just you might have some. We're going to have lifts off the corner, and we'll have to work around it for at least 1 week. I've never told you this, but there's a 20 dB gradient between different seats. So this seat, if you know anything about dB, every dB you go up is like exponentially 100% stronger to your ear. You have 80 dB here, 100 dB back there, which is terrible. Terrible. Is that a Spanish word? Terrible. Terrible. Is that correct? I'm not as dumb as I look. So they're gonna put the system up. It's gonna be equal sound. They say it'll be like 100% same dB across the entire church, which means, come on, it's gonna be great. We're gonna have it so it's a strong sound, but it'll be palatable, especially. I learned all about older ears. Until you come to the healing line, you hear the bass, but the treble it's a harder time to hear. But that takes money. But never fear. Savings is here. We have it set aside. Amen. So we've been a year and a half and shaking it out, but we got a great, 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 great deal from one of the largest sound people in the Southeast. So we're excited. You say, why do you say all that? Well, we're going to receive an offering in Jesus' name. That's why I'm saying that. I'm just trying to stir you up that your money goes to get the gospel out in Jesus' name. That's where it goes. So let's go ahead and receive the offering and tithes. From the back to the front, then we'll pray. Amen. Arthur Cooper is coming right here. one of my favorite people. Do you want it? Okay. Oh, you wouldn't. Yeah. Never mind. Oh, hallelujah. Lord, I just pray a blessing on these offerings and tithes on purpose. Everybody say it out loud. Mix your faith with this. Say, in the name of Jesus, I make a divine decree, a holy proclamation, easy for you to say, holy proclamation. In Jesus' name, that my tithes, opening at the windows of heaven, that my offerings are sowing seed for a great harvest. And I receive the blessing of God. I receive breakout in my money, in my home, in prosperity, in Jesus' name. Everybody say breakout. Say it again, breakout. One more time, shout it, breakout. Hallelujah. We speak it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Hallelujah. Talking about breakout, I'm hiring somebody over here. We're going to bush hog, clear our land, or a major portion. I'm going to put a tent there. We're going to have a dedication service. I got a lot of things I've been talking to John Amazzini about. And we're going to believe God to pay for that land. But we're going to have a meeting on that land under a tent. So no one can tell me you don't know where the land is. You can't tell me that anymore. But you're going to know what the land is, and we're going to believe God for the supernatural in Jesus' mighty name. I want you to turn to your Bible. You know, I'm speaking on victory. And somebody told me that I need to give out the sermons that I have lined up, and which I need to. But I want to talk about victory in every area. I want to pump you so full of victory that when you walk out of here, you're sparking it. You just go, it just every foot, victory, 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 victory. You know no defeat. You break off everything the devil puts on you. The devil's crazy, and he lives out there. And he wants to make life miserable for every believer. And we have so many negatives in our world today, more than ever before. It's like the world's going insane. But that's okay. We got the B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. Amen? By the way, you young people, listen to me carefully. If you're a young person, that's anybody under 60, that's okay. That's a joke. But if you're a young person, my son tells me, because he's our youth pastor, and I say, say what now? He said, Dad, you need to know, a lot of the young people, you preach one thing, but they don't really believe it because the media says something else, school says something else. I said, wow, really? Oh, yeah. Like when you speak against this, they're kind of for it because the world's for it. So they go with what the world says. You need to understand something about this book. And so I'm looking about bringing Josh McDowell, who's a great Christian apologist, here. Because his whole heartbeat is, for the young people, the issue is this the word of God?
Yes. Is it the word?
If it's not the word of God, throw it in the trash can. Let's just do what we want to do. But this book, and I'm just setting it up for some other sermons I want to do on this. This book can be tested scientifically, you can use logic, you can use many other factors, archaeological factors, that this book is just an amazing book. 66 authors that all wrote, that contributed to this book over 1,500 years, and all has the same theme. It all goes together like a jigsaw puzzle. Impossible. And that can't happen. Over like 480 prophetic words, which I got a book back there, give to your Jewish brethren, that has all the prophecies of Jesus, and every one of them came true. For this book is such an awesome book. And I'm telling you, if the cat don't like the way it's being stroked, let the cat turn around. Because this is the truth. And what's out there in the world is a lie. Do you understand that? And it's not being old-fashioned, and it's not being mean, because we have a loving God. But you understand that God has standards, and God's the one that set this all up. And the Bible says he looks down from earth, he laughs at the nations of the world. Yeah. The heathen rage against him. You know what God does? He laughs. Listen, you little pipsqueak. You're barely 100 years old. I've been through all eternity. This book's been around thousands of years. It'll be after you die and pop up daisies over your body. I'll still be here. It's amazing how people rise up in their arrogance and their pride and decide what life's about. It's like the book of Judges. Everyone does what's right in their own eyes. But you see, the shift of morality keeps moving, which it will move. When you knock this book out of our nation, anything goes. Anything goes. So we as a church have got to understand and teach our young people. As a matter of fact, you know what I'm doing? I'm praying about this. I'm so fed up with our young people tanking their faith when they go to university, that their faith goes down the toilet. And they either become agnostic and atheist, or, the stats are very bad. Very, very bad. They say only 4% of youth that are in church, when they get out of college, only 4% stay in church. 96 go the way of the world because they're being indoctrinated. Do you understand that? So I'm looking at doing a one-year sabbatical that you can work at the church. We'll give you courses, and we'll get you so grounded in the Word of God and in missions. So when you hit school, you'll kick the door open and say, Jesus is showing up here. You'll have a different mode of operation. No. Serious. It's like the attack mode versus roll over and die mode. We got to become more aggressive because the world's aggressive. They're trying to take your children at 5 years of age and try to pervert their little minds and requiring it that you are going to be perverted. You can be like us. No, we're not going to be like you because you're ruled by the devil. We don't want to be ruled by the devil. We don't want kids ruled by the devil. You understand me? This book's got to clean our minds out. And so I don't know about you, but we got to get far more radical than we've ever gotten before. And while I'm at it, let me just keep on going. The smartest thing you can ever do as a parent is keep your kids in church. Well, I don't like it. Make them come. And then have friends in the church that they can develop relationships with and give them jobs in church to do. Let them work in the church. I can't tell you how it'll help your children to grow up the way God destined them to grow up. It's the plan of God. Amen. And so more than ever, the church is the lifeboat. It's the ark in the world that's literally going to a devil's hell. We have to go almost apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah as to where we live today. Like, it's just ridiculous. But anyway, I'm saying that to say this. We're now going to go to the Word of God. Everybody said amen?
Amen.
And I'm talking about victory. I want to talk about an attitude of victory. Everybody say it.
An attitude
of victory. And I want to go to the book of Philippians, chapter 1. I'm going to read a few verses, a little bit more than I would normally read. But that's okay. You can handle it. Chapter 1, verse 12. But I want you to know, brethren, that the things which happened to me have actually turned out for the furtherance of the gospel. So it has become evident to the whole palace guard and to all the rest that my chains are in Christ. And most of the brethren in the Lord, having become confident by my chains, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preach Christ over from envy and strife, and some also from goodwill. The former preached Christ from selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing to add affliction to my chains. But the latter out of love, knowing that I am appointed for the defense of the gospel. What then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached. And in this I rejoice, and yes, I will rejoice. For I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. According to my earnest expectation, and hope that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but with all boldness, as always, so now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death, for to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you'd anoint me to give out the word boldly with freedom and liberty. I pray every hearer would hear by the power of the living word of God would come alive to them, and the Holy Spirit make it alive to them. Let it change their life in Jesus' name. And everybody said, to God be the glory. Hallelujah. Now, I love this because Paul is a man who epitomized what it's like to keep an attitude of victory no matter what's going on. Now, here he is, called of God to preach the gospel. In the book of Philippians, he's writing this book from a jail. And the Bible says he's with the palace guard. But we know, if you look it up in the actual Greek, it's the praetorium. The praetorium were the elite of Rome. They ran in between 3,000 to 10,000 in number, and they earned twice the pay of the regular Roman soldier. And they were to guard Caesar and other heads of state in the Roman Empire. And the way they worked it, if you were an important prisoner like Paul, you didn't want him to get away. So literally he'd be chained to another praetorium guard. They would take shifts. Well, how that works out for Paul is wonderful. He said, they know by chains are for Christ. So they get one guard, he shares Christ. They get the next guard, he shares Christ. You know, Christ is being shared in every one of those guards. Hallelujah. But then Paul goes on to share about the fact that some people are preaching Christ with the right motive, but some are preaching Christ out of envy. Out of envy to, about who? Against Paul, because Paul was too well known. Everyone talked about Paul this, Paul that. And they did not like Paul because he was getting ahead of them as a preacher. And they begin to preach out of jealousy. They had wrong motives. They had selfish motives. You know, just because you blow someone else's candle out doesn't make your candle burn any brighter. But I know it. It happens among preachers. I hate to say it. People are not for each other. But we're for every preacher here. We pray for every church in the city, particularly in Roswell. We lift them up. We help people. But I come from Africa. In Africa, they don't play. I've had cases where preachers in Africa have hired hitmen to take out another preacher because they want him out of the way because he's too successful. So we understand what Paul was saying was not fabricated. There are people that were preaching, but out of a jealous spirit. And he said, it added affliction to my chains. Why would I do that? Because here he is chained to some other guard, and he can't go anywhere. He can't get up and defend himself. He can't get outside the prison and go to the city and correct the wrongs. He's just got to sit there and hear what they're doing. And so it would chafe on him. It was another burden he had to bear. So here you are, locked up, chained to a guard. You've got people maligning you. You got people using the gospel wrongly, wrong motives. And here he is called to defend the gospel. And, you know, it gets so bad. But we do not hear him saying, oh, God, why me? Why me, oh, Lord? Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Nobody knows but Jesus. A song was written like that. My God, help us all. But you see, Paul, he has understood something. No matter what's going on, he kept an attitude of deliverance, an attitude of victory. He didn't allow the circumstances to crush him. And I want to address that because there's so many negatives in the world today. You may have come in here toting a devil yourself. You barely made it in here, but thank God you did. And now we're going to see what God can do to help lift you from that place. But he had total confidence in God that God would turn a crisis into a triumph, that God would turn a negative into a positive. He believed that, and he didn't doubt it. And you need to understand that your deliverance comes through an attitude of victory. If you have an attitude of defeatism, if you have an attitude of que sera, sera, what will be, that is a doctrine from hell. It doesn't work that way. You understand this? God wants you to have victory. The Bible said in 1 Corinthians 15:57, thanks be unto God that causes you to triumph through Jesus Christ. God has triumph for you, victory for you every single day of your life. But whether you walk in it and take it is another matter. But if you study this out, there are elements in here that tell us what Paul did to keep that spirit of victory, that attitude of victory. Step number one, if you notice over here, it's almost like an aside, verse 18. When I was reading that, I thought, that seems, what is this there for? He says, what then? What then? He talks about all the problems, but then he goes, what then? You look it up in another translation, it says, what does it matter? Another one would be, so what? Because sometimes we over-magnify the issues we face. We like to talk to other people and tell them how bad we really got it. And then people get on the, I can beat your bad. Yeah. You think that's bad. I got another bad. That's worse than that bad. We get into bad competition. But you know what? Paul, he said, no, we can't go down that road. He said, because you understand this, that when you are living in this world, you're going to be attacked. And we had Simone Noel, the great teacher who's still around today, that taught Norval Hayes' deliverance camp, which I've been to. You know how Norval Hayes runs things? Wide open. 7 a.m. till 10:30, 11 at night for 5 days. That's Norval Hayes. But they taught us, they said, the first thing when you're attacked, you're supposed to say this. It's only attack. It's only an attack, and it's no big deal. We just go say, you know what? We're going to get attacked. You can say, it's going to be a test. I will be tested. Your faith will be tested, and we all got different kind of tests. But don't exaggerate and glorify the attack. Amen. That's why I love the brethren in China. I could never get the Chinese pastors. I asked them, could you tell me about your torture? Could you tell me about your imprisonment? They refused. You know why? They just want to talk about the victory. And they want to keep a smile from ear to ear. I said, they spoke to me. They spoke to me. So we got to understand, we cannot make a big deal about it. It's only attack. You know where we need to be? Have you been to the beach with a big old beach ball? You know those big old beach balls? Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Yes. Just seeing if you have any fun. But you take a beach ball, and you know, that beach ball, it's hard to get underwater. And you might get it pushed down, but the more you push it down, it's going to shoot out. It's going to just shoot out somewhere because it's not made to be underwater. You are designed to be a beach ball. A beach ball that when the waves of adversity come at you, you just bounce right back out. You bounce right back out. You don't stay in the water. You bounce right back out in Jesus' name. You have an attitude of victory. You're not putting me under. Now, if anybody surfed, and anybody surfed out there, three people. Okay, the rest of you go along with it. But when you surf, or body surf, or boogie board, and the wave catches you, and you get rolled in the wave, you know what you end up with? Sand in your swimming suit. That's what you end up with. You know, I've always, you know, if you surf the Atlantic or the Caribbean, the biggest waves are like little, they're like ripples compared to other waves around the world. Like you go to South Africa, on their beach, they hold world championship international surfing contests in South Africa. Those are real waves. Another place of real waves is the north shore of the island of Oahu in Hawaii. Real waves. They don't play. There's a place called Sandy Beach. I lived in Hawaii for about 5 weeks, and I'd swim every day. I'd go out to the beach every day, and I had to learn to respect these waves. These waves are unlike normal waves. You get out there, and you're doing your thing, and I tell you, the first time, I thought I was in a washing machine. I mean, I said, Jesus, help me come up for air. Lord have mercy. I'm trying to come up. And by the time I finally kind of landed like a beach whale in the foam, my shorts were packed with sand. All I saw was sand. I thought I was going to die. Remember, I struggled out there. One day I saw a brother who came straight from the mainland. I could tell he was from the mainland because he was white as a sheet. And he got there, and he was rather a portly individual, has two kids, and he gave the wife his camera, and he's stepping out in the wave, but he thinks this is Florida wave. He don't know what's going to be happening here. And he's sitting out there, and his back's the wave, and they're filming it. Bam! That wave hit him just as hard as you can. Knocked him. Now he's in the surf. Now the undertow is so powerful, it rolled him back in the waves and sucked his swimming trunks right off his back. True story. So he's filming, the lady's filming, we're all laughing. So now, in the foam, he's trying to get his pants back on. So he would waddle around there like this, wallow, 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 and about the time he had it off, wham, another wave came and sucked it right back off. That poor man went through about 3 or 4 times. We were howling on the beach. It was the funniest thing we ever seen in our life. Finally, the poor man had to just stand up and moon everybody, put his pants on, stomped out, and he kept telling his wife, and she's keep filming the whole time. Gotta get this. This is. But you know what? Life wants to suck you under the waves. Life wants to put you in a washing machine. And by the time you come up for air, out of one problem, here comes another one. Yeah. So you'll always live under the water. Always live just eating sand. Yeah. But that's not the plan of God. The plan of God is for you to be a beach ball. Hit you, pling, can't get me, pling. But some of you came in here, and you know what you're dragging? You were dragging behind in the spirit a deflated beach ball. No longer has any air. You drug that thing in here, and you're singing that song, No One Knows the Trouble I've Seen. The other dumb songs. These are songs written by people in the church. Sick, sober, and sorry, broke down, disgusted, and sad. I went traveling for Jesus, and he took everything I had. Stuff like that is craziness. But you understand this. It's got to be no big deal. So what? I'm attacked. Number two, go down here to verse 19. For I know that this will turn out to my deliverance. Ooh, did you hear what he just said? For I know I may be chained. I may be in prison. I may be people talking against me, but I don't know. I know one thing. I know this will turn out to my deliverance. Yeah. There's something about I know. He's talking about the power of the revelation of the Word of God on the inside of your spirit. That you know. You know on the inside of you that you are made by God to be a champion in Jesus' name. It's a knowledge based on the Word of God. And here's the deal. No matter what happens against your life, you know that God has deliverance for you. In the mighty name of Jesus. I'm telling you what, you got to get your faith stirred up in Jesus' name. My God can turn it around. He can turn something negative into positive, a crisis into a triumph, and God specializes in that. And you got to get your, the first step is, this is a test. Make your mind, I'm passing the test. I'm going to have an attitude of victory. I got to know what's mine. I've got to know that I know that I know that I'm born of God. I've got to know that I know that I know that I'm a son of God. Whoever's born of God, 1 John 5:4 says that you will overcome the world. You got to get that inside of you. I don't care what it looks like. I'm overcoming in Jesus' name. I've got to know Romans 8:31. I've got to know if God is for us, who can be against us? If you've got God on your side, you're going to win. I don't care what it looks like. You're coming out on top in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. And don't tell me, listen to me, well, Pastor, you don't know where I've been. You've not had the trials I've had. Oh, really? You want to compare trials? When was the last time you had a doctor tell you you got 90 days to live? 90. When was the last time you had the SEC, the FBI show up and say, listen, we're going to take this church from you? I can go on and on and on. It's very real. And I've determined a long time ago that I'm not going to let the church pull me under into a slough of despond. Because you think you got problems. Try me as a pastor. I got all your problems. Yeah. People come to my office like wheelbarrow full of problems. They just come in and just dump it right in my office. There. Pretty soon my office will be filled with problems. If I listen to all the problems and they don't get to me, I'd get a twitch. Somebody starts coming to the hall. Hey, Pastor, I need to talk to you. If I didn't let go, but let me tell you what. I'll tell you what. They would deflate my balloon, and pretty soon I'd be in a white jacket and be carrying me out to the hospital going, and I'd be saying, ministry. Ministry. People quit the ministry all the time because they get sucked under the undertow. Yeah. Amen? Yeah. But it's not the plan of God. The plan of God, you remain a beach ball. Yeah. Yeah. Amen. You come up out of the waves in the name of Jesus. Now, he says, I know that I know. I know, 1 Corinthians 10:13 says, that God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tested beyond what you're able to bear, but will, with the temptation, provide a way of escape. There's always a safety valve with God. Yep. I feel like I'm going to get crushed. You will not get crushed. You got to know. You see, this no, what happens about the no? The no says, I'm not calling my problem not a problem. Faith does not deny the reality of the problem. But faith will not allow the problem to overcome them. You've got to attack the problem with your faith in Jesus' name. You've got to know. No. I know one thing. The Word of God is here to give victory to me. And then you know what? I'm believing God in Jesus' name that whoever's born of God overcomes the world, and I'm overcoming it in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Number one, it's a test, and I'm going to win this test. When I go through anything, like some pastor come against me, I've had pastors sue me. I'm just praising the Lord, or else I get sued. $1 million. For what? Because we didn't give them what they wanted. They wanted a big bonus to lift the church, and I was on the board, so we're suing everybody. $1 million. So you got to get an attorney, you have to defend the suit, and then you need to pray forgiveness for them every day. Yep. Does that make sense? Yep. Sometimes I've had two lawsuits. People just start suing the pastor. Please, don't sue me. Go to God. But, you know, you have to deal with these things. But you got to get with God. You got to know that you know that you know that I'm going to enjoy my pastoring, and I enjoy pastoring. You know what? Well, you know what your problem is given to Jesus. So when you're ping, 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 boom, boom. Not on me. Ping, boom, boom. Hallelujah. Seriously, you need to do the same thing. You got to know that you know that you know. You got to know that you know what you have in Christ. You know what? That you have been made a champion through Jesus Christ. That God gave you victory on a silver platter, and he wants you to take it. It's a way of life. It's an attitude. It's a stance. It's called a victory stance. In Jesus' name. Because I know my God.
Yes, amen.
He's got victory for me. It's such a big deal. Let me tell you something. I asked these medical people, I said, what's driving the cost of medicine up every year? They said, it's the pharmaceuticals. I said, what's number one pharmaceutical? He said, it's psychological drugs. He said, about a third of America is, you may be taking it yourself. Keep taking it till you get delivered. But a third take drugs to keep their mental equilibrium, emotional stability. And it just grows every year. Because you know what? America's losing it. The land of prosperity. We have everything we need. But yet people want to blow their brains out. I'm so sick and tired of our young people getting attacked by the enemy and taking their life out. Or contemplating taking their life out. Or you may be here thinking, at one time the devil said, go take your gun and end your life. Let me tell you what. That's a defeatist thing. That is a thought from hell. It's not victory through Christ. It's defeat to the devil. And you got to rise up and say, you know what? I'm having an attitude every day. It's called a victory attitude. In Jesus' name. You got to know some things, though. And he says, I know that through your prayers and the Spirit of Jesus Christ. It's the only time mentioned in the Bible that the Holy Spirit is called the Spirit of Jesus Christ. The Spirit of Jesus Christ means that when you were born again, the Holy Ghost moved in there. But the Holy Ghost represents Jesus Christ. The second person of the Godhead moved on the inside of you. You've got power, brother, in Jesus' name. He says, I know through your prayers. Through your prayers and the power of the Holy Ghost. I don't care, as a born-again, spirit-filled believer, what the trouble is. You can pray yourself out of it, even if you can start off with nothing but Hosamasikiyo. I can't tell you the time I've been hit in the head with major stuff. I get my face in the carpet, and I just begin to pray. And I will pray, and I will pray, and I will pray, and I will pray, and I will pray. I'll pray 1 hour, I'll pray 2 hours, I'll pray 3 hours, I'll pray four. But I will pray till I can feel the fire of God come on the inside of me. And you'll have the strength to rise up and say, no, in Jesus' name. That's why I love to pray. We pray a lot around here. We pray every morning. We pray tonight. We prayed Friday for 2 hours. I got a bunch of people praying. I love to pray because I know the power through the prayer. If you don't pray, well, you'll be oppressed. Take your pills. Take whatever else you got to take. But let me tell you what, praying in the Holy Ghost is the answer to Prozac. Praying in the Holy Ghost is the answer to a lot of your issues. But you go because Jesus afforded you a spiritual victory, and it's in the Spirit, and he gave you the tools. The Spirit of the Lord Jesus Christ himself wants to be loosed in you because all Jesus knows is victory.
Yep.
And that's all he wants to ever give you is victory.
Yep.
And when he got up, if Jesus himself got here to preach, he wouldn't give you some soft, sloppy sermon. Well, we all know the trouble you see. Well, we just want to pet you. We're so sorry. Come here, let me burp you. It wouldn't be that way. Jesus will love you, but he would tell you like it is. He said, victory is yours, whether you have it's on you, not on me.
Yep.
He told the centurion who asked to come heal his servant. Jesus said, as you have believed, so it will be done to you. You see, it's a matter of what you're going to believe. What are you going to believe? I don't know about you, I'm going to believe God's word.
Yes.
And you got to get radical in these last days. You're going to make a determination. I'm a beach ball. I thought about the analogy. I could use beach ball, golf ball. You know how golf ball, when you kick it in the lake, goes right to the bottom. Stuck with all the algae and the frogs. But a beach ball. If we played with beach balls, we'd never have that problem. But the third thing he said is number 20. He says, according to my earnest expectation and hope, that nothing shall be ashamed. But with all boldness, as always, now Christ be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. I love the word, according to my earnest expectation. Everybody say, earnest expectation.
Earnest expectation.
That is a real powerful word. I looked it up in Vines. They put that together. It is a unique combination of words. Go look it up. It's really meaning to stretch your neck out or stretch your whole body out and focus on one object that you are trying to receive and you never take your eyes off it. It's like if you want to be healed of a major sickness, you got to see yourself well and you got to look for it and you can never take your eyes off it. You've got to add to it. You got to get books. You got to get CDs. You got to get meetings. But whatever builds your faith to take it off you, you got to get very serious. You got very laser focused. Too many people get too distracted. They treat a major disease like a side item. Can't be a side item. It's got to be the item in your life. That's what you read. That's what you focus. That's what you get to. Yeah, that's what you confess. You better be on your game, baby. Otherwise, they'll miss you. People play with this thing. In one sense, faith is easy. In another sense, it's not easy because it's to those who apply themselves to it. Are you still out there?
Yes.
Earnest expectation. It's a concentrated, intense hope which ignores other interests. It's an attitude of expectancy that God, something good is going to happen to me. Remember, Oral Roberts would say that every time he had his program. Something good is going to happen to you today. It just would bless you when I'd hear it. Oh, say it again. Something good is going to happen to you today. In fact, make it personal. One, two, three. Something good is going to happen to me today. Turn to your neighbor. Make it second person. Something good is going to happen to you today. Do you realize when you speak those words out, something in your spirit said, woohoo, woo, hallelujah. Something good is going to happen to you today. It's hope out there, expectancy out there. That's how Paul lived. Paul lived like, I don't care if I'm in this jail, chained to the guard. I don't care if people malign me. Something good's going to happen to me. And you know what? I'm focusing on the good. You know, when you focus on the good, you can start getting happy. You focus on the good, 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 good. Something good. Oh, well, look, they've said this, they've done that. I don't really care. I'm not focusing on the negative. I'm going to focus on the positive. God's going to turn a negative into the positive in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Then Ephesians 6:13, it says, having done all to stand, stand. Stand what? Stand in faith. You stand to say, I believe this to happen to my life. I believe it. Don't doubt it. Stand. You know, the prayer of agreement is a prayer we don't often use enough. One time I was teaching on a prayer of agreement that for two weeks on Wednesday night. I lined everybody up. I said, if you want a prayer of agreement, I explained to them what it is. Holding hands is nice, but that's not really significant. It's spiritual. You can agree. One person can be in California, another person in New York, and you'd have the prayer of agreement because it's in the spirit. It's in the spirit. Not only everybody agrees. They think they agree. But if you agree in the spirit, Jesus said, Matthew 18:19, as two of you shall agree as touching anything that I ask the Father, two. I didn't say these words. He said them. If you will find an agreeer, it'll come to pass. So we laid all these people. I mean, we had like a couple dozen. We went through, my wife, we prayed the prayer of agreement. The prayers were off the chain. The next few weeks, it's like every prayer was being answered across the whole circle. I told my wife, we got to get more serious in our praying. We're too lax. We're not really purposeful. And the devil will talk to you, well, you've lived a sinful life. That's why God can't answer. Well, you know, there's some provisos in this prayer. No, there's no provisos. If two agree. Everybody say earnest expectation. I'm telling you, we got to get very serious about, no, I'm not settling for what this is. Whatever is negative in your life, maybe it's a marriage, maybe it's your body condition, maybe it's your finances, maybe it's your husband, maybe it's your wife. Whatever you don't like, it's like, no, this is not the way it should be. This is not the way it should be. I'm telling you. Expectation that will not stop. It says, having done all to stand, stand. How long do I stand? You stand till you win. You got to make a determination. I don't care. If I die doing this, I will die doing this. But I will not die mumbling, grumbling, complaining, and going negative. I'm going to stay a beach ball all my life. In Jesus' name. You're not putting me under the waves. My expectation is for the goodness of God to be made manifest in my life. on my expectation. Paul's expectation. It's going to work out to my deliverance.
Amen.
See, your attitude is a mindset that determines your behavior. Your attitude of victory is a mindset that says that God says to you, I don't care what it is that's negative in your life. If you'll trust me, I can turn it around. But I need you to stand in faith and not back off. Don't get religious and back off. Blessed be God, plant. And if you've got to die in that spot, die in that spot. But you are not backing off.
Amen.
Don't back down. Don't compromise. Don't back off. Don't back away. Stay with it. Allow God to show up and do a miracle for you. A miracle of turnaround. He can take what's upside down, inside out, and make it back to front and right side up. God specializes in that. But can he find a man, can he find a woman that will stand long enough in faith and not back off to bring the miracle to you? Or will you capitulate to your emotions and the opinions of others and the circumstances of life? You've got to make up your mind. I'm not capitulating. I have earnest expectation. It's what drove Paul. The believer should have earnest. When you get up in the morning, blessed be God, this is going to be a great day. Not looking at the news, not looking at the other body, somebody else in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So don't let other people mess up with your attitude.
Amen.
You know, I get around people. There was a time in church, people in my office, and I hired these people. They start going negative. They start getting moody. One day they'd be happy, next day, oh, blah, blah, blah. It just sets a negative Paul in the office. Just a. And finally, I told my wife, it got so bad. One day I said, I don't want to go to work. I said, why? Because it's depressing in there. The office is depressing. She said, honey, may I remind you, you're the pastor? She said that. Let him go. Just let him go. I said, that's a new thought. Let the misery go. But I went to prayer about it. And by the grace of God, the very next week, one of the people, I won't mention who they are, said, the Lord's lead me to leave. And I acted very sober. Inside I was going, yes! I said, is that right? Is that right? Yeah, we're leaving. Well, God bless you. May the Lord bless you in your new door of opportunity. They left one more. The next week, Dick Mills gets in my car. Pick him up at the airport. Dick Mills is a prophet of God. Now he's in heaven. Sits in the car, shuts the door, he says, there's a person in your office you need to let go right away. I said, say what? How come you knew that? And he said, it'll be better for them and better for you. I said, you got that right. The better for me part, I know. So I go down, I go there, and I see this individual, and I call my office. I said, I got some good news. He said, what's up? I said, the prophet of God spoke. I give it all on him. Yeah, the prophet said, that you are to be let go and that God would give you a better job. What? I said, oh, yeah. We got to obey the prophet now. So I prayed, and we sent her for the next opportunity. In a month, she called me, and she had a job at a big denomination institution. They paid her more money, and she said, Pastor, because we go around here. But over there, she said, it's so wonderful. We walk around the mornings with our coffee and discuss things while we're sitting around. I said, that's not how we roll. Not around here. There's no. But it's good for you, but it's even better for me. Hallelujah. I tell you what, I hired some happy people. Hire happy people. Hire people that like to be happy and smile in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, is okay? Yeah, we're pretty good now, and our staff's pretty good, pretty good. As long as they stay happy. I just want you, part of the job description is, are you a beach ball? Are you a beach ball? Can you stay in joy? Can you stay above the waves? Or you get sucked under and drag the seaweed with you? All right, that's 3 points. There's one more point, and here's the crowning point. You ready for this? Notice here, it says here, verse 18. What then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached. And in this I rejoice, yes, and will rejoice. You know, The epistle of the Philippians is called the epistle of joy, because it's joy throughout it. In 4:4 of the same book, chapter 4, verse 4, he said, rejoice the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. In the vernacular, it says, all joy, this is another translation, be yours at all times in your union with the Lord. All joy be yours at all times in union with the Lord. And then another one says, keep a glad spirit, which reminds me of Proverbs 15:15. It says, he that has a merry heart has a continual feast. And Proverbs 17, or let me get this right, Proverbs 23:17. It said, he that that a merry heart does good like a medicine. You know, you were created to be merry. You're created to be happy. You're created to be joyful. Things work better when you're happy. Did you know that? It's like a well-oiled machine. Keep oil in it. Keep gas in it. Make sure all the fluids are right. The motor will run and be happy. It'll purr. You are made to be happy. God created you to be happy. He created you to be joyful. You are not made to be sad and melancholy and morose and carry the weight of the world. And don't wait for the problem to go, because let me tell you, the devil, by the time you finish that big problem you're dealing with, he'll have another one waiting for you. He'll always be another one. You know, there's no such thing in church. There's no such thing as it's all at peace. There's always some trouble. Someone's saying this. Someone's doing that. Someone's getting divorced. Someone's got this. It's constant. There's no such thing as, well, we got it all together. No, you just ride the horse. Woo-hoo! And you just say, Jesus, help me not to get thrown off. But I can stay in the joy, because joy is what God has given me to inherit. And so if you keep your joy, you keep your victory. Paul understood that. He said, listen, I'm in the midst of all this trouble, but I know that my joy is going to push me through. Because joy is like the flag in your heart that tells God that you are up in your spirit. Amen. Not about you, but I like joyful people. Because something about joy, when you got your faith right, you got expectation, you're excited about life. You get energy. You notice that when you're depressed, you feel so energized when you're depressed that you want to clean the house. In fact, clean all the windows. Restack all the stuff in your closet. Does that happen? No. You get a big bowl of ice cream, turn a TV on in your depressed state and eat what you shouldn't be eating. Come on now. And you watch TV till your mind goes cross-eyed. No. It takes a joyful spirit to be on top of the wave. But you understand, God created you to have joy. And joy is the flag that's flown in your heart that tells everybody else, including the devil, you know what, you've not got me. I'm a beach ball. You can't bring me under. Because God, listen to me, I have a right to have victory every day.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
God created me to soar. God created me to climb, not to crawl. God created me to fly, not to fall. God created me to be strong and solid, not to waver and crumble. I tell you something, God created you. Understand this? You are made in the image of God. You were created to be a champion. You're created to be a victor. You're created to be a conqueror. That's the language God uses. That's who he sees you as.
Yeah,
and it's an attitude of victory. You got to get up with a toot on. An attitude. You got to get an attitude. No, I'm going to walk in victory. Therefore, I'm going to walk in joy. And I know whatever I'm facing, God's got it. He's turning it around.
Amen.
He's turning it around. He's turning it around. He's turning it around. Amen. In Jesus' name. It puts a jig in your step. Smile on your face. Know you see people dragging their balloon behind them? Get it off them and help blow it up. Praise God. You're made in the image of God. Everything's going to be all right because Jesus got you real tight. Who is he that brings accusation against you? Who is he that condemns you? Romans 8. God's the one who acquits you. Jesus died for all your sins. Jesus rose again so you can have a brand new spirit. Jesus sits at the right hand of the throne of God. He's got all authority. He gives it to you. Jesus has given you authority, and he's given you the knowledge that he's interceding for you. Do you know what? You have got little children. Overcome them, for greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Okay, I got it now. Woo-hoo, I got my joy back. Woo-hoo. Ooh, bum, 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 bounce out of here. Boing, boing, hallelujah. That's what church should be. It's a refilling station. Dragging in your deflated balloon. Singing your sorry song. If it's not a song, you mumble under your breath. I've been serving God. It just happened to me. And they start taking it out on the pastor. I've learned this long ago. Basically, they look for a person to blame. Look around. There he is. It's the pastor. You think I'm laughing? It happens over and over again. He's the problem. He's the problem. Well, let me explain about your problem. When you run your mouth, and you're talking your negative trash, justifying your sorry position, you know it can't be me. The world's all wrong. No, victory is your decision. It's given you on a platter. Whether you have it or not, it's you. Not me. You. John Bevere, the great teacher of the Word of God, I love his story. He was with a mega church, and he was the youth pastor, and he didn't like what he had to say. He was getting depressed about it. He was getting upset about it. So he began to run his mouth about the pastor. Bad decision. He said he'd sit there, he'd get nothing from the sermon. He said, that's the driest thing. He don't know how to preach anymore. We need to leave the church. He's gone dead on us. So the Lord began to speak to him about his attitude. Because he was under the waves. He had lost the air in the balloon. He's under the water. He's got sand in his britches. He's got so much sand he can hardly stand up. The Lord said, you need to repent. It's not him, it's you. And it's your attitude, your little moody attitude. You and your little problem. Licking your little song. Get over it. I love my wife. You can't cry in her office. Oh, yeah. She rose up our kids that way. Three kids. There's a, you can't cry around me. Suck it up. Yeah. We're talking business. If people start crying, then all of a sudden feel sorry for them. Never get to the square one way with them. Stop it. I'm just warning you. If you want to counsel my wife, good luck. Now, me, I'm a little more compassionate. You can cry on my shoulder. At least for 60 seconds. Then after that, I'll go into her mode. No, okay, stop that. That's enough. But John Bevere said, he repented before God. He called the pastor. He said, Pastor, I was wrong. I've been running you in the ground. I've been eating some negative food, talking it out of my mouth. He said he repented. He said the very next Sunday, both spiritual ears on either side of his head opened up. And he heard the word like he never heard it before. And he began to weep copious tears because he realized for 6 months he'd missed the word because his own negativity had shut down the ability to hear God's man. We create our own little problems, folks. If you don't have victory, it's on you. No, you know, it's my situation. I don't care. I don't need to know your situation. Look in the mirror and say, I have met the enemy. And it's me. No, it's true. We give the devil too much credit. It's us. So Paul was saying, now listen, you do not have to go down any single wave. You don't have to go down depression waves. You don't have to go down sorry ways. You got to do what I do. It's only a test. No big deal. I've got to know that I know what I have in God. I've got to have a supernatural, eager expectation, reaching out that thing. What's coming to me? I see a new business. I see my family whole. I see my life walking with God. I see it. Don't ever get off it. And then never lose your joy. Never. Never lose your joy. Never. It said, he that hath a merry heart has a continual feast. I like that. You know, life's not worth hardly living if you're always depressed. Oh, it's another day. I pray it was evening. When evening comes, oh, Lord, I wish it was morning. We go from worrying, sorry state to the next. Hallelujah. But you know what? My Bible says he raised us up together with him in Christ Jesus. That's Ephesians 1. He raised you up. Everybody say up. Up, up. He raised you up far above all principality, power, mind, dominion. Up there. Hallelujah. You are his creation. You have worth. You have value. I want to say something to some of you here. The devil wants to beat you up. He'll belittle your personhood. He'll talk about how bad you've been. He'll talk about the things you failed. And he'll cause you to be your own worst critic. You'll beat yourself up more than anybody else. Shouldn't have said that. Shouldn't have done that. How much? You know what I'm talking about, anybody out there? That's why the Bible says we need to forget those things that are behind. It says forget them. Forget them. That's Isaiah. Isaiah, and I'm closing now because it's later than it's ever been. Isaiah 43:18. It says, forget the former things. Forget all the past. Forget your mistakes. Allow God just to push them away from you. And behold, I'm going to do a new thing in your life. Hallelujah. I have a right to victory over Satan. I have a right to have a life full of joy. I have a right. No, I really can't. I look at all the other people that are suffering. I don't care what they're doing. You have got to be filled with the presence of God and the joy of the Lord. But there's one verse I want to close with, which really kind of sets it off to me. When I was reading this, I said, God, this is really powerful. I shared with you in 1 Corinthians 15:57. Thanks be unto God that gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Who always causes us to triumph through Jesus Christ. Then it goes on to say, that you might become steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Now watch this. He's saying, when you have a spirit that has a victory attitude, you won't shut down from doing what God's asked you to do in church. I want to just say this to you. I know people that have been in church for years, the ones who were very active in church, but are no longer. The hardest people to get off the dime are people that had the t-shirts, but now they don't do anything. Because either they got offended, or they got tired, they got something happened that took the fire out. But the Bible says, when you have victory in your heart, you truly have it burning on the inside of you. It energizes you. It activates you. Do you know something? We're made for relationships, and relationships receive love, but relationships must give love. If you don't give love, well, I give love to my family. Anybody can do that. You don't get no awards for loving your family. But can you love the unlovely? Can you love the hurting? Can you love the broken? And not about you. I fully believe this, that I'll be rewarded based on what I give out of my life for others. And I believe it. So the race is on. If you want to live in a two-bedroom condo, God bless you. I want to live whatever God's got best for me. I'm not backing down for nothing. But I found out something, that if you want to be mobilized, if you want to work for God, you can't carry a sorry, broken spirit. You can't carry a whining heart. You can't carry that. You got to carry a winner's heart. God made you be a winner. That you, when you get up in the morning, you have victory in your soul, victory in your mind, victory in your words. You think like a winner. You talk like a winner. You walk like a winner because you are a winner. You're a winner in Jesus' name. You say, God, here's my talent, here's my time, here's my money. Use me to reach a hurting world. Use me. And some of my greatest ministers of the gospel in this church are the ones that fight the greatest domestic battles you've ever seen. They got all kinds of things going on. Husbands wigging out, stupid stuff happening. But you know what? They just go for it anyway. Lister Haynes right here. She's going to Trinidad and Tobago. She had all kinds of things happen to her and her family. But this is like her eighth trip. She raised money. She goes down. She's holding her own crusade. She's becoming a Holy Ghost juggernaut for God. Give her a hand. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And so you know what I want out of this whole church? I believe in God. I'm going to preach victory. I'm going to give you a B12 shot every Sunday. So you all of a sudden, you come out of here. When you walk out of here, you go, victory, 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 victory. It comes out of you when you get up in the morning. Victory. Victory. No depression. Just victory. Just joy. Just joy. God can turn it around. What about it? He's going to turn it around. He's going to turn my situation around. He's going to turn it around. He's going to turn it around in Jesus' name. You come in here. You got so much victory. You don't walk in here with your deflated balloon. Pastor, would you inflate my balloon up? No, you got your balloon full. You're bouncing off the ground. Hallelujah. You come here with a dance. You're walking. You can't even walk across the parking lot. You got Luis. Delivered. I mean, the man should be dead. He's alive today. You come down the aisle. You're just dancing. You know, people gravitate to people with excitement. They gravitate to people with enthusiasm. They gravitate to people with a big old banana smile. They gravitate to people that are full of joy. Somebody bows and just says, oh, I need that. Come wash over me. Come wash over me. But you got the Molly Grubs, you walking around singing, woe is me, head down. Boy, you got us a bad report. Later, Gator. Nice. We've been praying for you. But not right now. I ain't got time for it. But you know what I'm talking about? Everybody has victory through today. Say, in the name of Jesus,
I receive,
and I'm going to walk in
the victory
Jesus purchased for me.
Purchased.
No more sad days,
bad days,
but only good days,
glad days,
because Jesus Christ
truly brought for me
victory every day
in Jesus'
name.
Hallelujah!
Let's pray. Father, I thank you today that you've afforded us an attitude of victory. Everyone in this house can have an attitude of victory. That, Lord, forgive us for we have sucked lemons and got a face longer than a Missouri mule. And we try to share lemons with other people. We've had lemon parties. God, forgive us. We shared lemons. But, Lord, today we want to lay down the lemons. You've got greatness for every person here. Paul rose up to share the gospel to the known world, even to Nero Caesar himself. God, we got kingdom builders and nation shakers in this church that will not be hindered and hampered by the works of darkness. But we're going to do what you've called us to do. We're going to walk in the victory you've given us. If you're here today, you're really honest with yourself and God. It's okay. We're in the body of Christ now. This is ministry time. But you're really honest. You say, Pastor, let me just tell you something. I've had so many attacks on my life lately that my shield of faith is so many darts, I'm dragging it on the ground. My breastplate of righteousness is literally falling off my chest. And the belt of truth is slipping. But I need help from heaven because I know what God has given me, but I need help to get there. You may be fighting so much stuff, and it's okay. God has mercy for you, and He wants to help you. He wants to help you. He wants to break the negative cycles. He wants to lift the heavy burden. He wants to set captives free. So if you're here today and you'd say, Pastor, would you pray for me? You just describe what I'm going through. If that's you, raise your hand. Say, that's me. Raise your hand. There they go everywhere. Here, there, and everywhere. All over this place they're being raised. Up in the balcony. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Well, the balcony looks pretty saved. Put your hands down. Keep your eyes closed. One other thing. I always want to let people know that there's an opportunity to get right with Christ. I don't know if you came with a friend, someone that doesn't normally go to church. You're here today, and if you're really honest, you say, you know what? I don't have peace with God. I don't have peace with Jesus. But you want to have peace. You want to be made right. You can be made right today. God will make it right. But He needs your heart to reach out to Him to say, oh, God, I want to come back to you. I want to make my life right with you. Or if you never received Christ ever in your life before, today can be your day. He loves you so much. He gave His life for you. All you do is receive the gift of salvation. It's a gift. All you need to do is say, yes, Jesus. So to make your life right with God or receive Jesus, if that's you, you say, I need that prayer, raise your hand. That's you. Quickly, just slip it up. In the name of Jesus. Thank you for that hand. Thank you. Thank you. Keep raising him. Keep raising him in Jesus' name. I want to get it right. I want to get it right. Now, that's you. You raise your hand. I want you to stand quickly to your feet. Quickly. Just stand to your feet. Quickly, wherever you are. Just stand all over this congregation. Even if you didn't raise your hand, just stand up. You say, well, that's me. I should have been included in this prayer. Now, I want you to do this. I'd like you to quickly get out of your seat. Come stand at this altar quickly. Don't even hesitate. Just come out of your seat. Stand at the altar. God's got something wonderful for you today. In the name of Jesus. Just as I am. Hallelujah.
just as I am. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Jesus, hallelujah. Everybody say, thank you, Jesus, for setting captives free. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. All right, I want you to do this. I want everyone to close their eyes. I want everyone to pray this prayer. It's a simple prayer that we do before God. God will hear your prayer. Everybody join me in this prayer. This first prayer is going to be for salvation. Get your life right with God. And when you pray the prayer, pray from your heart. And as you believe what you're praying, God will come visit you, set you free. You say, well, that prayer doesn't apply to me, but it doesn't matter. Just pray it anyway. Everybody say, here we go. Say, oh God, I need you today. I need your forgiveness. I need your salvation. And I come to you right now, the best way I know how, just as I am. So take me, Lord. I repent. I turn my back of all sins in my life, all failures in Jesus' name. Wash me in your blood. Come in, Jesus. Say it again out loud. Come in, Jesus. One more time. Come in, Jesus. Move into my heart and take my life over. And for the rest of my days, I will follow you in Jesus' name. Everybody shout out, I'm born again. I'm saved. I'm on my way to heaven. Jesus lives in me. Hallelujah. Glory. Now, is everyone here today? I just want to have this prayer. Put your hands up in the air and just pray this prayer. If you should be up here, you need to run up here, because it's God honors faith. It takes faith for prayers to work. Faith and obedience. You obey what God asks of you in a service, you're better off. In Jesus' name, He comes to help you. I'm going to pray for you, then I'm going to pray with you. Father, I pray for everyone standing here today with their hands raised to your throne. And I believe, oh God, that you want to draw a line in the sand today. The days of defeatism, brokenness, heartache, despondency, heaviness, oppression, depression, dark days, bad days, sad days are over in Jesus' name. I break the power of hell over your life. I break the darkness that's on you in Jesus' name. I command every lying devil that harasses you and attacks your mind, go from them in Jesus' name. And I cover them with the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I pray, oh God, the Spirit of God, come upon them even now. Now pray this prayer together. Let's pray this prayer. Say, oh God, I need you today. And I know Jesus Christ came to bring me victory every day in every way. So today, I reach up to heaven and I receive by faith victory in my life, that I will have positive expectation for my future. The old is past. The new has come. It's a new day. It's a breakout day. In Jesus' name, thank you for anointing me with fresh joy. Say joy, joy, joy. Joy, joy, joy. In my life. On my life. No more heaviness. No more weight. Just joy from the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Give him glory. So good to see you. What God began, He's going to finish. In the name of Jesus, I speak it over you, that you step all the way into everything He has for you. And don't back off. Don't allow the enemy to pull back that which God has already planted in you. You're going to see the greatness of God fulfilled in your life. In Jesus' name. God's got some special thing for you to do. You know that? He does. In the name of Jesus, we love this, love our people here. We love you. Jesus is doing a work in you. touches your mind. He touches you. Don't be the same. In the name of Jesus. You see, change. This day is a day of change. A day of change. In the name of Jesus. Now, in the name of Jesus, I lay hands on these two. But I just hear this so strong. The call of God is irrevocable. It's on your life. God says, if you'll put your trust in me, I'm going to take you through to the very place we need to be. But you'll stand on that mountain and declare the goodness of God, the greatness of his mercy, and his magnificent love for you. So, Lord, I just release your anointing. There'll be a place of rest in your presence, a new beginning. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Shalababora disiki. Hallelujah. I just receive right now this touch on your life in Jesus' name. Everybody say, thank you, Jesus, for your touch. Your touch brings victory to my life. It's really the truth. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. Free! In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I speak this to you. No more oppression. The enemy talks to you. It's broken. Jesus' name. Out! Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. Jennifer, you diamond in the rough. You woman of God. I've done with lesser things. The past is past. It's behind you in Jesus' name. You're going to rise up for the new day. You're going to walk in the victory and the power of it in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus, I release my faith with your faith that what the devil has stolen, God will restore. And that even as Paul stood in that prison cell with eager expectation, he said, God, you're going to make this out to my deliverance. The Lord, you're going to put in my brother Joe that expectant spirit, that he knows that you've got great things in store for his ministry, for his calling, and for his life. The devil might try to slow you down, but he cannot stop you. Do you understand me? In the name of Jesus. But there's an anointing on your life. Don't compromise. Don't go the way of the world. Don't go the way of darkness. But walk in the light of light and allow God to promote you. For God has got your back. And let the joy of the Lord be your strength. Joy! Ha ha! He he! Ho ho! Ha 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 ha! He he! Sometimes you gotta practice laughing till you get it out of your spirit. Ha 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 ha! He he he! Ho ho ho! Anointing with joy, Lord. Take off the garment of sorrow. Joy, 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 joy. Here's another one that needs joy. Joy. Lord Jesus, you do the work. Joy, 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 joy. Joy, 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 joy. Now help me out. Ha ha. He he. Ho ho. You're doing real good so far. Just pick it up a little faster. Ha ha. Hee hee. Ho ho. A little bit faster. Ha ha. Hee hee. Ho. Ha 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 ha. Ha ha, devil. You can't have her. Ha 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 ha. You can't have touch her. Jesus' name, she walks in divine victory. We let the anointing of God lift her up, and she walks out of darkness into the light of God, and she stays in the joy of the presence of God. Whoa. I feel him on you. In Jesus' name. Have I missed anybody? Did I miss you, honey?
Yeah.
Oh, I apologize. I can't even blame the ushers. It's just me. Lift your hands up. Lord, she's precious in your sight. I pray the touch of God on her, that she moves in a new place of victory and freedom. Touch her, Lord. Touch her from the top of her head, the soles of her feet. Free! He loves you so much. He loves you. Touch her, Jesus. Touch her, Jesus. Touch her, Jesus. Whoop! What you looking at? Raise your hands. You're a Carolina Panther?
Yes, sir.
I can't pray for you. No, I'm kidding. I just. That's a joke. You know, that's a joke.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Now, Lord, I just pray a blessing on my brother. He came because he wants every bit of darkness gone. I command that every oppression, all darkness, oppressive spirits, go from him. Loose him and let him be free. In Jesus' name. Everybody stand to your feet in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We're going to make melody in our hearts to the Lord. I taught you that song. Remember that? That's in my, it rings in my spirit. We've got to be happy in God. You know what I'm saying? Oh, we got so much stuff. Well, let's lift our hands to heaven. Father. Sing. Making melody in my heart, making melody in my heart, making melody in my heart unto the King of Kings. Come on out. Making melody in my heart, making melody in my heart, making melody in my heart unto the King of Kings. Listen. Bubbling joy of God. I want you laughing. I don't really dance. I just mess around. But you got to express the joy in you. You know what I'm saying? God is such a good God. All right, next Sunday, another B12. Tonight, 6:30, we have prayer. The 12, we meet at 5. Whoever's part of the 12 is at 5. So I want to just pray and say that if you're a guest, we have something for you right through those doors. We want to meet you. But greet these three people. Tell them you love them in Jesus' name. And we're going to go out singing that song. Here we go.